Socialism is exactly opposite to that. Socialism is where state is the owner of all of us. For example, we all pay taxes today. We pay in the sense they take it from us. Nobody pays the taxes voluntarily.
Taxation is theft.
It's theft. It's absolutely. Taxation is robbery. All right? Theft is at least when we are sleeping and they take away without our knowledge. This is daylight robbery.
Hello everyone, welcome to my channel Anarchy for Freedom, India's home for conspiracy research and free thinking. Today I have a very special guest with us. His name is Madhusudan Raj. Madhusudan Raj is an Austrian school economist. He presently works as an assistant professor of economics at the Department of Human Resources Development, Veer Narmad South Gujarat University, Surat. He is the founder and president of Mises India Institute. Madhusudan, thanks for coming on the show. It's great to have you.
My pleasure, Yohan.
So, if you guys don't know already, Madhusudan is one of the only, I would say, people in academia in India who are actually teaching Austrian economics, which is a totally different school of economics compared to the normal Keynesian one that we've been taught in school. So, if we can start with, you can just tell the viewers a little bit about your journey as to how you got into Austrian economics.
Yeah, so Yohan, when I was a child, you know, I used to see poor people toiling out in hard sun. And I was always wondering, how can I help these people? So when I was in 12th standard, I started reading economics for the first time. And then I realized that this is the subject, you know, which can really help people. Now, when you are young, you are very romantic also, like, you know, you think from your heart and everything. So I decided that I'll make my career into economics. And then when I was in my second year of my bachelor economics major, I realized that becoming a teacher is very important because this has to do with changing minds of people, ideas, because world is ruled by nothing else but ideas. So that's how the whole journey started. And then I started reading economics. You start with Adam Smith as usual. And from very childhood, I was very freedom minded. In my family also, my mom and my dad, they used to give me a lot of freedom. So I always tasted the freedom that, and I never liked to be controlled or ruled by somebody else. So naturally, my inclination was towards Adam Smith. So when I started reading Adam Smith, I thought that yes, this guy's ideas are proper for, you know, changing the world for, you know, better. But then I'm very radical from the very beginning. Radical in the sense I think to the extreme that what is the root cause of the problem. I don't stop in between. I don't like to look at the proximate causes. So Adam Smith did not really appeal me very much because he will also talk about, you know, having custom duties and having a minimum government and government running the, you know, education system. So I was looking for somebody who is much more, you know, radical and who can go ahead of that. So then I came across, then I took subject of history of economic thought, and that's where I read Mises a little bit. They don't talk about Austrians very much in history of economic class, mainstream classes. So I read him and I realized that they talk about Hayek a lot. So I thought that yes, you know, Mises is going, you know, 2, 3, 4 steps ahead of Adam Smith. But then Mises will also talk about having some government, although he was, you know, anarchist at many places. And then I started stumbling on Mises Institute's website, which was previously known as the Ludwig von Mises Institute in Auburn, Alabama. So that's where I started reading Rothbard. And once you read the Rothbard, your world changes, the whole point of view changes. So that's how I came to know the Austrian School of Economics. And I don't remember the day when I came to know that, but that was the day. And since then, I have never looked back. Then I decided that I will go and do work into this school of thought. And then I went to 2008, I went to Mises University, Auburn, Alabama. And I did my Mises University, and now I am part of the group and part of the scholars club and everything. And I came back to India, like what happens to everybody who goes to Mises University, they all kind of decide that we will go back to our home countries and try to do something better. I remember my mentor, Walter Block, he told me that Madhusudan, in 10 years time, I want India to be a libertarian country. I said, I will try my best, sir. I cannot promise you anything. But here I am, it's been 10 years and I'm still trying whatever little I can do. So that's how my journey is into the Austrian School of Economics and Libertarianism.
Wow, that sounds amazing. I can actually relate to your story quite a bit, because even when I was in college and studying finance, the only version of economics we got was Keynesian. They never even mentioned the names of, like you're saying, Mises or Rothbard or Walter Block or any of these people who actually contributed loads of academic literature on how society can actually operate without needing a state. So why do you think this is so that, you know, we don't even get to hear about these intellectuals and authors who have created an entirely different school of economics? You know, at least they would tell us that, okay, there is this people over here who are talking about this, and we're not even told that. Why do you think that that's the reason for that?
Yeah, because the system, public education, public schooling system is designed by the state itself to control the public. So it is very obvious that they are not going to allow the people to think, you know, as if you read the book of Murray Rothbard, Anatomy of the State, that's where he mentions that the most dangerous person for any state is the person who can think on his own. So obviously, somebody who is, you know, what we say, you know, whatever doctor ordered, you know, you're going to eat that. So when Keynes comes and says that, yes, government is very good, he's going to, you know, they can bring the economy out of recession, they are going to teach that. And most of the teachers, most of the economists are also employed by the state. I remember a study in America where, you know, the data says that around 60-70% are on the payroll of the US Federal Reserve, the central bank. So intellectuals in states have a very close nexus from very long time. During times of kings and queens also, the intellectuals will be inside the court. There are very few honest and, you know, moral people who will realize that the state is a morally wrong system and get out of that and try to expose that system. So that is the reason why they never will teach you what the reality is. Most of the teachers, they don't even know. As I say, most of the teachers are there for salary. They are government servants. I don't even call them teachers. Because a teacher's job, even if you are Keynesian, your job is to, you know, give students all side of the picture and let them make up their own mind. They have to be objective, but I don't see that thing happening, you know, anywhere. There are very few such people who are objective, open-minded people. So state has a role to play, that they are, you know, spreading their propaganda. And that's why they don't allow government, you know, this education system to get out of their monopoly. They don't want to really privatize in the sense, truly privatize, not give it to their friends like Adanis or Ambanis. So that's the reason why they don't teach you the right thing, because that's what the government do not want to hear. If I, for example, I tell my student that if I become RBI governor, I will go and dismantle the RBI. There's no way you can expect the government to appoint me as an RBI, you know, as an RBI governor, if these are what my ideas are. So that's the problem, you know. It is their bread and butter. So they're obviously not going to expose students. The schooling system is, you know, as John Taylor Gatto and other great, you know, John Holt, these great educationist teachers used to say, it's for dumbing down the kids. As Mankin said, actually Mankin, that the real aim of education system is not enlightenment. It is to bring down everybody to a safe level so the state can control everybody very nicely. And that's why they are not going to, you know, give away the power, the control of the education system. Yeah. And that's why I am a big proponent of homeschooling and unschooling movements also. I will very strongly advise your audience, whoever is listening to us, to please homeschool and unschool, you know, your children. If you're young, if you don't have kids, if you are expecting, then please don't send them to school, because that is where the problem starts.
Yeah, that's very true. What he's saying basically is the state has control of the minds of the people, and if it can control you for the few years of your life early on, it's very easy to make you complacent for the rest of your life and to opt into the system. Another name for the state education system is also government indoctrination camps, as many people have called it. So that really comes in the way of us being able to learn and actually explore ideas that can set us free compared to a state controlling the education system, which obviously wants us dependent on it. So maybe where we can start with understanding India is, let's go back in history a little bit, see when the British really left the country. And we had a lot of central planning going on back then. We had five-way economic plans, which are basically adopted from the Soviet Union. So what impact do you think these plans actually had on India? Did it make us better off than when the British were there, or, like, you know, did we not do so well? And that eventually led to also leading to globalization, privatization, liberalization in the 90s and the debt crisis. So maybe if you can just give a broad overview of how socialist policies affected our state and where we are right now.
So when, I mean, we got independence, I mean, the masters only changed from the Britishers to local people started ruling us. There were actually two camps, what we call the Mumbai School of Economics and the Delhi School of Economics. So there were at least one person whom I know, the who is the, you know, our Austrian forerunner in India, Professor B.R. Sinoy. He was very much against the central planning and adopting of the social, you know, Soviet Union's five-year planning and everything. But Jawaharlal Nehru, he did not like him because he was, so he wrote a dissent note, and he left the planning commission, and then the central planning started. And what happened, whatever goal they had envisaged, came to nothing for 30 years, starting from 50s to up to 80s. Inflation was very high, income inequality increased, poverty went up, unemployment problem was still there. And as Professor Raj Krishna mentioned, for 30 years, the average economic growth rate of Indian economy was 3.5. And he gave it a name, Hindu growth rate. And I think we are again going back in that direction, when the country is going in that direction of becoming maybe Hindu Rashtra in future, maybe we will have Hindu growth rate of 3.5% forever. So central planning and socialism really damage our economy very much. At that time, I remember Milton Friedman also visited India. Milton Friedman, the famous free market Chicago economist.
Nobel Prize winning
economist. And he advised the Indian government to, you know, he said that you have a lot of energy in your country, a lot of entrepreneurship, because India is a very old civilization. Almost 3,000, 4,000 year old civilization. And when you have this old civilization, entrepreneurship is everywhere. So he said this, unleash this energy, allow the market to work. But again, as I said, because Nehru was so much in love with Soviet Union, he just went for socialism and central planning. And the opportunity cost of having government for this long, for 70 years now, is huge. I mean, I cannot even mention that what opportunity cost, you know, we had. We could have a much better life without having such a big government, or this government without this state. But then that's the opportunity cost of having a government. And then, as you said, in 1990s also, Narasimha Rao and Manmohan Singh did not reform because they wanted to. It was, you know, market forces that compelled them. The situation was so bad that they could not even import oil. The forex reserves dwindled to like 1 week or 2 weeks foreign reserve for importing oil. So they were forced to privatize. And that was this privatization, liberalization, LPG. It's not actually privatization. This is what we call fascism. So they gave contracts and started disinvesting. And they started giving companies to their friends like Tatas and Ambanis and Billas and Bajaj, and now we have Adanis and all these people. But at least they were compelled to loosen their grip from the market. And what we had, what Mises called, is hampered market. And even that hampered market brought a lot of successes. So your and my standard of living increased like anything. I mean, if you ask your dad, if you ask your grandfather, their life was, you know, miserable. I remember my father spending whole his college in just two pair of clothes. No, I can wear this blazer and we can drive into cars. It's because of that LPG policies. At least Manmohan Singh had, you know, he was compelled, but he went in the right direction. That we have to open up the economy. And that's why we are enjoying this, whatever little better standard of living we have. We have a lot of inequalities, right? A lot of people were left out from all these things. But at least something good happened. But again, as I said, it was compelled on the government. They did not voluntarily want to do that. And that's what I think is again happening in India. But I don't know, this government is going in an absolutely wrong direction.
So basically, what you're saying is that the privatization that we had in the 1990s, how would that compare to true privatization? Like, you know, you're saying that, okay, this is a fascist thing and they're basically handing out these companies to their corporates. Right. But how would that contrast with the privatization that we are talking about,
right,
where we don't want the state's monopoly on the law, right, where we want true free market competition,
right,
in almost every area of that. So this is also a problem when I tell people that, right, you know, we should privatize this sector or that sector. Right. They basically think that the state's crony friends are going to come and take over it. So, you know, could you help alleviate some of those concerns?
Sure, sure. I can give you example from education sector because I am in academia. So, for example, I know every year around 100 or 200 people apply for licenses for starting private schools, so-called private schools in Surat city. These are not private school because you have to take permission of the government. So they will give license to 2-3 people who can bribe the bureaucrats and who has friends in the system. And only they can start the schools. So I don't call all this so-called private universities and private school private. These are government licensed monopolies. All these companies, Reliance or Adani, or these are government licensed monopolies. Actual privatization will be government will simply get out. And they will, for example, if I want to start my own university, I can start. There is nobody to stop me. The only thing is, suppose I want to buy a land from somewhere. I will go to the owner of that land and I will ask him, we will bargain, we will struck the deal, and I'll get that land and I can start my school. And I'm not going to harm anyone. That ethical boundary is always there. And that is how my school will start. And I will compete in the market and I will teach whatever I want to. I do not have to follow the syllabus that is mandated by the government. So even today, private universities will have to follow the University Grants Commission, UGC's rules and regulation. So there is nothing private in India. Everything is either outright owned by the state or it is state licensed monopolies. So right. Real privatization is when the state just disappears, they just go out and allow right entrepreneurs to take over the businesses. It will not necessarily go to Adanis or Ambanis. If they are good, they will remain in the market. But if you are very good, then maybe you will run the Mumbai, you know, metro. You will run the Mumbai local trains. Somebody else will also be there. There will be many people. I think in Mumbai, Reliance Power gives, you know, distributes power and everything. So why just that one company? There can be 10 different companies. There can be 50. We don't know what the market configuration will be. There can be 100, there can be 200. We are not one to decide. The market participants will decide. So that is true privatization. What we have today is what I call fascism. What we have is government licensed monopolies.
That's very true. Yeah. So like he's saying, when I bring this up, even to the people that I'm trying to spread this message to, it's like, you know, they can't imagine that if the state doesn't exist, you know, how will we be able to do all these things?
Right.
And, you know, how will all these things operate? So maybe you can touch a little bit about, you know, why people have been made to think that they need the state for these services, like roads, for example, and like, you know, defense and things like that. Like, why do we only need the police, for example? You know, why can't there be competing defense agencies offering the services to us, and then we choose what is the best for us, like he was saying. Also, you alluded to earlier when you were talking that there will be some ethical boundaries, but you know, people think that without the law, people don't have any deterrent from being able to, like, you know, do anything that they want. So could you just expand on the basic principle of Austrian economics and libertarianism, which is the non-aggression principle, and talk about how that contrasts with state socialism?
Right. So libertarianism is very, very simple and a very beautiful political philosophy. It has two pillars. One is private property rights. And how you determine private property right is what we call the homesteading principle, or what Stephen Kinsella and Hans Hermann Hoppe say is first appropriation principle. So for example, I and Johan are going into jungle and we see an apple lying on the ground. We both are hungry. We have to decide whose apple is that. We have to decide ownership of that apple. There are two ways of deciding whose apple is that. One is we fight, whoever will win will get the apple. That is what we call the might is right principle. which is basically uncivilized and a barbaric way of determining whose ownership is on that apple. The second one is this: whoever will go and pick it up the apple first, because apple was unowned before we made it our property, so that first appropriation of the physical property. So that's how you establish private property right. And the second pillar of libertarian philosophy is what you call non-aggression principle. That once you establish the private property rights, there is nobody else who can violate your private property rights. The first thing is you own your body, so we have self-ownership. Then whatever you are appropriating by using your body, that becomes your private property right. That becomes a physical extension of your personality. But that thing must be physical, it must be scarce, and it must be unowned. So when I say scarce and physical, that excludes ideas. So libertarians don't believe in copyrights and patents and all these things. You cannot own ideas, you cannot own reputation. So you only can own physical things. So this is a very simple libertarian philosophy. Individual, he owns himself and whatever he has appropriated by using his body. Socialism is exactly opposite to that. Socialism is where state is the owner of all of us. For example, we all pay taxes today. We pay in the sense they take it from us. Nobody pays the taxes voluntarily.
Taxation is theft.
It's theft. It's absolutely. Taxation is robbery. All right. Theft is at least when we are sleeping and they take away without our knowledge. This is daylight robbery. So that problem is always there. So they get their very survival depends on robbery. So socialism is an immoral system to begin with. Because as we say, you know, you cannot rob Peter to pay Paul and call it social welfare. What the state does is they take my 1,000 rupees and give me 100 rupees back. And they say that, you know, we have done your social welfare, which is absolutely ridiculous. Yeah. Because the money was mine to begin with. You just, you know, rob me and then you are giving something back to me and then you are saying that we are providing you services. So I tell my students and everybody who is using government roads or government currency that we are not the customers of the state, we are the victims. So we did not voluntarily choose these people to serve us, right? And we are not paying the taxes. So socialism is state ownership and it's slavery basically, right? Whether they are taking away 10% of our income or 50% of our income doesn't matter, right? Taking away money forcefully is robbery, nothing more than that.
Yeah, and I can attest to that. Basically, there's a slave in America called Frederick Douglass.
Yes.
So even he himself wrote about, he was an actual slave in America, and he wrote about the fact that when his owner would basically take most of his income and give him some, he would feel worse than if he just took all of it away. Because
yes,
just, you know, giving him some made him feel like he had a claim to the whole thing. So that was a slave saying that taxation is worse than slavery.
Exactly. Okay. So my very, you know, I always challenge the statist people, those who believe in state and government. I always tell them that if your idea is very good, then why not make taxation voluntary? I mean, let's see how many desbucks are in this country. I mean, all these people who are, you know, I call them Facebook warriors and WhatsApp university warriors. If they really have to show that they are serious about their Deshbhakti, what they can do is they can show it through their action. Let them walk their talk. Let them put their money where their mouth is. But they will never do that. See, it is always easy to do charity when you are doing charity from somebody else's pocket. It is always difficult to do it when you are doing out of your pocket. That shows that how serious you are about these beliefs that you are having. I'm sure nobody will pay taxes voluntarily. I know I ask my students in the classroom, they all say, we will never pay. So we never pay the taxation. That's socialism. And it's an immoral system to begin with. Also inefficient because as Mises proved more than 100 years ago, socialist calculation is impossible. They lack the price and profit and loss system. They don't know where the resources must flow. They cannot solve the economic problem of what to produce, how to produce, and for whom to produce. So resource allocation requires private property right and the free enterprise, free market system.
Yeah, that's a brilliant summary of why socialism basically doesn't work. You know, people try to say that, oh, it just, you know, we didn't try it good enough, or it was the wrong people in charge, and if we get the right people in charge, then they can make it work. But there are much more fundamental reasons, like Madhusudan was alluding to, like the calculation problem. Basically, Ludwig von Mises wrote a book a very long time, like you were saying, economic calculation in the socialist commonwealth. Right. Please go and check that out to get a deeper understanding of why socialist economies will always fail, no matter who's in charge. You know, even if it's a benevolent dictator in charge, it is still going to fail for some fundamental reason.
Yeah, I also want to point out, when you say benevolent dictator, see, because many people are making this kind of arguments that, okay, but the prime minister's intentions are good. Good intentions are never enough. We should judge these people by the consequences of their actions. You know, as there is a popular saying in English, that the road to hell is paved with good intentions. So good intention, you know, I mean, I'm not ready to believe that there is honest politician. I mean, it's like believing in honest burglar, right? So there cannot be honest criminal. But even if you assume for the sake of argument that there are honest politicians, even they will not be able to solve this economic problem, because they don't have the help of the market price and profit and loss system. They cannot calculate. And that is why fundamentally it will fail. The challenge is insurmountable. And we saw that with the collapse of Berlin Wall and USSR. So I remember a socialist professor, Heilbronner, he wrote in New Yorker's magazine that Mises was right. That he was right that socialist economics cannot calculate, and it failed. But anyways, you said people will keep on trying, one politician after another, thinking he's going to save us. The problem is they are not going to save you.
So maybe we can come now to some of the problems associated with socialism in specific that the public at large think are good measures. So for example, things like rent controls, price controls, import restrictions, and minimum wages, and like all these different things that people on the ground, you know, who really haven't thought of these ideas very deeply, they think it's a good thing. The government is trying to save us from these greedy capitalists. So what economic consequences do people suffer when the government imposes these various things on the people?
So let me take minimum wages as an example. Narendra Modi government is now going to bring all the labor laws under four major heads, what they're calling labor codes. So one of the payroll code is that, wage code is that, they are going to provide minimum wages to around 55 crore unorganized workers of India. The problem is that people have to think in this way. Is it that easy that if there is some economic problem, like low wages for the workers, then you just pass a bill in a parliament, you make it a legislation, an act, and the problem will disappear? It's never going to be like that. You know, just today morning, I was, you know, discussing with my students that if it was that easy, what were you waiting for? We will just pass Remove Poverty Bill 2020 and voila, the poverty is gone. But it never happens. You know, a thinking person will always start when everybody stops. So when, for example, when Arvind Kejriwal passed last year in October, he increased the minimum wages of unskilled workers, semi-skilled workers and skilled workers in Delhi. So what happens with this legislation is they only increase the cost of production of the employer without increasing the revenue. For example, you are getting 40 rupees per hour working in McDonald's today. And suddenly, and according to that, the profit and loss calculation will be there. If you're hiring 10 laborers and you're paying them 1 hour 40 rupees, so your cost is around 400 rupees. And let's say in 1 hour, those workers are producing 600 rupees of revenue for you. So your profit for that 1 hour is 200 rupees. Now here comes the government, some busybody people will come and tell you that, oh, the wages are very low, or the workers themselves will demand, like what happened in America, they wanted to, you know, increase their minimum wage from $11 an hour to $15 an hour. Government is very happy when people go to them because they get importance. The politicians like it when there is crisis. So they will immediately sign the minimum wage law, or they will increase the minimum wage. Now, what will happen with McDonald's? Now, I was paying 40. Now I have to pay, let's say, 80. The revenue of those 10 workers hasn't gone up. What has only gone up is my cost. So instead of 400, now my cost is 800. My revenue is still 600. Now I am making 200 rupees losses. So what I will do? I will just fire the workers so that I can bring my profit margin back. So minimum wage law is being passed to benefit the laborers. The very same law is going to make them unemployed. Not only that, as happened in America, all this fast food chain, they introduce automation. So when you go to, for example, you go to Singapore, you go to airport, you see this kind of kiosk where you can self-order your thing and they will remove the workers. So that is how government creates unemployment. The same thing happens with rent control, with medicine. You know, for example, I read that they try to control the price of heart stent few years back. So if you are going to control the price, the market price is 80,000 rupees per stent. Now the government is telling the pharmaceutical companies that the price should be 20,000 rupees. Nobody is going to produce heart stent now because there is a, you know, there are laws of demand and supply. So the law of supply says that the price comes down, the quantity supplied of the product will come down. So what will happen is more scarcity. So when the government is controlling the price of essential drugs, the drugs will disappear from the market. All right. I was reading a few days back that Imran Khan was controlling price of naan and roti in Pakistan. What will happen is that naan and roti will disappear from the market because nobody is going to sell the product for free. See, people need to understand that there are laws of economics and these human action laws are immutable no matter what the time is and no matter what the environment is, what the country is. These laws are going to work. They are like laws of physics. Like, for example, if I jump from the third floor of a building thinking that gravity will not pull me down, I'm a fool. So that's the problem with economics also. They are like that. If you think that you are going to print money and you are not going to generate inflation, that's stupidity.
And Arvind Kejriwal comes to mind with this whole Delhi giving free rides to women and stuff like that.
No
someone's
free
going to pay for it.
Absolutely.
And it's going to be you, the taxpayer.
Absolutely. Yeah, but then, and I'm seeing, you know, people keep on stumbling from one guy to another. Now they think Arvind Kejriwal is going to save them. I mean, these people are not going to save you. These people are going to murder you ultimately, either directly or indirectly, because as Rothbard said, the state is nothing but a gang of criminals writ large. So stop believing in them, right? You have to take responsibility of your life on your own shoulders.
Thanks. That gives a good, pretty much summary of the problems associated with certain socialist measures that people, the public at large, think are good, but people don't understand the economic reasons through which they really don't work. And this problem also comes up with a lot of people thinking that capitalists are the problem, or, you know, they are basically stealing wages from the workers by profits are basically theft. Like, you know, that's what a lot of people think. So can you actually explain the economic function of the profit and loss system and how profits aren't really evil?
Right. See, for example, when we don't have capitalism in India by far. We don't have capitalism anywhere in the world right now. Capitalism is pure private property ownership. We don't have it anywhere. What we have in Singapore and Hong Kong is a minimum government. The government is still there, the state is still there, but it is interfering the less. Now, we don't want to go into the discussion of
minarchists
versus anarchists. Let me talk about the function of profit and loss. Everybody talks about profit, but people forget losses. Because if one person is making profit, there are 10 people who are going out of business at the same time making losses. Now, in a free market system, in a capitalist system, you can only make profit in one way. And that one way is to serve your consumer. Satisfy the most urgent needs of your customers by providing them the best quality services, best quality goods at the minimum lowest possible prices, a price that is allowed by your cost consideration. Only in this way you can become rich. So for example, if Bill Gates is rich, he's rich because he first provided services to people. He provided computers to them. Why people are buying Apple iPhone? Because they like that product. And in that process, Steve Jobs became a billionaire. Now, what is wrong with that? If you are providing, so for example, if somebody is coming, your milkman, somebody who's delivering milk to you, if he's doing a pretty good service, then you are going to give your money to him voluntarily and happily. And in that, he becomes rich. There's nothing wrong with that. Earning profit, honestly, is not wrong. What these corporatists or fascists like Adanis and Ambanis are doing is not profit. This is ill-gotten money.
They're basically using the state to,
pass
laws on their favor.
Yes, to fleece the public. Yeah. Yeah, not only pass the laws in their favor by removing the competition.
Yeah.
So when I give you an example of minimum wage law, that hurts the small people most. All this control, for example, now they are going to ban palm oil from Malaysia. That is going to hurt the Indians the most. Malaysia may be fine with some other buyer, but it is you who is going to get into trouble by not importing Chinese product in this country. I think if you don't use Chinese product, then Indian economy will pretty much stand still. I'm sure in Surat, at least where textile and diamond industry is very famous, most of the textile looms are Chinese imported. Everything that you use is China. There's nothing wrong. It doesn't matter for us where the products are being manufactured. I mean, this whole make in India and everything, or America first and France first, is all state propaganda. I don't care from where my clothes are coming. What I care is how much money I'm spending for that and what value I'm getting for
that. The quality of the product.
The quality of the product. That's what matters. I mean, I don't want to buy something because it is make in India and it is, you know, horrible quality and very high price also.
Yeah.
Ultimately, you damage your own country by doing that. You are harboring bad entrepreneurs, inefficient people. You want your business to remain into their hands.
And also, profit and loss serve as key signals to entrepreneurs to obviously enter businesses, exit them, and, you know, a lot of different things.
Yeah, so when I said profit, you know, if you don't serve your consumers well, you will exit. They will not. See, as Mises says, the real democracy is the market democracy, where your note is your vote. So by using your note, you are giving everyday vote to some businessman that you stay in the market, you provide me the services, because you are the best guy. This is not like politics, where once you vote for them, for 5 years, you cannot do anything. And even after 5 years, you cannot do anything.
This reminds me of something one of my friends was telling me, like, you know, just very recently. We were standing next to a station, and there are a lot of poor people. And I was basically telling him that, you know, the government is responsible for making these people poor. So he's like, without the government, how would these people get money? So I just basically told him, look, if you're able to channelize your energy and you're able to convince other people to vote for someone who will actually go in, take your own money and then give these people, you would obviously have enough energy to, you know, channelize that much more effectively and collect the money yourself and then directly give it to them. So instead of basically having the option to go once in 4 years and have to choose on different masks on the same face, like we're saying, like, you know, most of these politicians are controlled by the people who are funding them and putting them in power. We can basically use our own money to vote every second, every hour, every day, and, you know, affect the people who are serving us. And the free market system is nothing but you and me and all these people just interacting voluntarily and trying to serve human needs and desires.
Exactly.
This brings me to the topic of banking and money in general, because, you know, a lot of people think that central banking is a tenet of capitalism or something, and that the fiat currency situation that we have today and all of these banks going under, like the PMC bank had issues. Just recently, there's another cooperative bank, I think from Goa or something, who had directives issued by the RBI to cap the withdrawal limits by 35,000 bucks and so. So what do you think? Is our banking system actually capitalist, or does it have a tenet of socialism infused in that as well?
Far from it. It's pure socialism. RBI, our central bank, is a monetary central planning authority. And many people have, you know, this particular propaganda is very prevalent in economic classes by the mainstream professors and economists, that RBI is autonomous institution. I mean, I will tell you that, go on RBI's website under the About Us tab. You just read that who owns the RBI. It clearly mentions that RBI is 100% fully, wholly owned by the government of India. So if something is owned by the government of India, how can that become a capitalist institution? No way. Historically, central banks evolved to fund the government, to fund the kings and queens, because they needed money and bankers had the money. So they made a nexus, and they gave promise to each other that when I'm in trouble, you will fund me. When I get in trouble, you will help me. So when the banks get into trouble, the government will come and tax us and give that money to them. And in, you know, behalf of that, the RBI will keep on monetizing the budget deficit of the government. And they just use all these beautiful names so that, you know, they can hide the nefarious, you know, tactics. So for example, if you and I print currency at home, rupees, then they will call it counterfeiting. But magically, when RBI does the same thing, it becomes monetary policy.
Yeah, I mean, I tell this to a lot of people, that basically we've given the power to these banks to literally just create money out of thin air without having to take any effort, without having to create that wealth themselves. They just believe that they can print money and then, you know, they can stimulate it in the economy and that's going to generate growth and all these things that, like, you know, investment and stuff that they talk about. But the money that they're creating is not really resulting in that, right? It's just resulting from a transfer of resources from one person to the other. Just because some central planner landed up increasing the money supply, it doesn't really mean that we're going to have increase in goods and services. It's just going to transfer wealth from one person to another. So can you talk a little bit about who does inflation really hurt? Like, when we say increasing the money supply, first of all, the government has muddied up the waters and told us through the education system that inflation is a rise in prices, when actually the Austrian school view is that inflation is just increasing the money supply, and then the rise in prices are the side effect of it. So who does this inflation really benefit in the economy?
Right. First of all, the definition of inflation is not just Austrian. If you look before 1980s literature, even mainstream used to define inflation as an increase in the supply of money and credit. But they very cleverly changed the definition from cause to effect. But anyway, inflationary policies, they do three things. RBI generates three major problems in economy. One and foremost is business cycles, what we call the boom bust cycle. Right now, the Indian economy is into recession, because the GDP is falling since last 4 or 5 quarters now. That's a typical recessionary situation. So the generator of this boom bust cycle is RBI solely, nobody else, and the governor of the RBI. We can pinpoint the individual also, and the monetary planning committee, whoever 10 members they have. So these people, they are the ones who are generating this boom bust cycles into our economy. Second thing, they also create price inflation. So price inflation, rising prices of goods and services, is not a cause of inflation. It's not inflation. It is one of the effects of inflation. The second and the third most important effect that inflationary policies have is income and wealth inequality. So when RBI prints currency, fresh rupee notes, they will give to their friends, somebody who is close, a businessman, for example. So when they go and spend that money currency in the market, the prices have not gone up, so they can grab these scarce resources very easily. So for example, if you have printing press and I don't have, and you want to buy something, you will just print some currency and you'll go and buy it. So that will make you rich, make me poor. So this is what happens. And when that money ultimately reaches the hand of the person who is at the last end of that cycle, that chain, that is basically you and me, the prices have already gone up, so we cannot, the purchasing power of that currency, rupee note, has gone down. So we cannot purchase anything, the products are already gone.
So would you say inflation is a hidden form of theft then?
It is taxation. Inflation is, see, government has three sources of revenue. I am calling it revenue scarecrow. It's loot basically. Let's not call it revenue. One is taxation, second is market borrowing, the third one is inflation. Most people don't know that even as we are speaking, RBI is monetizing so much of government's debt.
Yeah,
they are doing operation.
I think I read that is the third largest holder of government bonds.
Absolutely. Yeah. If there is no RBI, then government cannot fund all these welfare schemes and wars. RBI also funds all these wars. And as you and I know very well, war is the health of the state. So that is how the state becomes powerful. So RBI is behind all these things. So inflationary policies ultimately hurts the people. It helps the debtors. So for example, if you borrowed 100 rupees from me, and in future you have to give, let's say, 110, and now the currency's value has already gone down, you benefit.
Yeah.
The creditors are suffering. So the people who are saving, they are suffering. People who are borrowing, they are happy, because they can continue to borrow at a very low interest rate, and when they default, the government will just simply write off everything.
So, but just to play devil's advocate a little bit, like the government is saying right now that there's no aggregate demand and we need to stimulate aggregate demand. What's wrong in them just printing up money and giving it to a bunch of people to stimulate that demand? Right. And how does that contrast with the Austrian view that we actually need savings to create investment?
Absolutely.
And just by taking debt, we cannot...
Right. First thing is money is not wealth. Wealth is real goods. So for example, the blazer that I'm wearing, or the onions that we are going to eat, or the apple, that's real wealth. You cannot print that wealth out of nowhere. Currency or money is just a common medium of exchange. And what it is going to do when you print it is only going to increase the price. It actually, price inflation is not the price of, let's say, onion going up, it is the purchasing power of the rupee coming down. So that is the problem. So inflationary policies are not going to, you know, help anyone that way. And as you said, it's not the demand that is the driver of the economy. This Keynesian language that car, you know, economy is a car and government is a driver, and you can just stimulate it. It's a very big problem. These kind of analogies are very fallacious. First of all, economy is not a car. It's an organic system and a very delicate system. If you tinker with it, you are going to, you know, create problems. Economy runs from production. I know, I always tell students and everybody that the simple principle of economics is that you can consume only when you have produced something. Without production, how can you consume? If I'm just going to print, you know, some rupee notes and going to give it in your hand, you will go and demand something, and that production has not gone up. Because as I said, government cannot print onions. As if, like, right now there is a lot of scarcity of onion, the price was like 200 rupees per kg. Government just can't simply tell RBI that, oh, you go and print some onion and our problem is solved. So wealth is not rupees. So you can, and it's not about aggregate demand. As Ricardo said, demand is never a problem. Supply is the problem. We have to understand that from where the production will come. Once you produce more, then you can consume more also. So government is destroying all the production, you know, capacities of our country, our economy, by destroying the capital structure, by disincentivizing the saving, by hurting the savers. And whatever saving we have, they are just wasting it into all kind of bundugals, all the welfare programs and warfare programs. So once, on one side, you are destroying the production capacity of the economy. And on the other side, they are going to give money in the hands of people. This is nothing, but this is going to create a problem like Zimbabwe, hyperinflation. Already the recent retail inflation figure came out red hot, 7.35, which is around a decade high. I have never seen this high print of retail inflation. So maybe we are going in the direction of Zimbabwe. I hope people, they can Google Zimbabwe hyperinflation. Yeah.
$1 trillion note.
$100 trillion note. So maybe we can go in that direction. Subramaniam Sami yesterday was saying that we can print Lakshmi's photo on rupees and that will solve the problem. And he was giving example of Indonesia. I mean, the inflation is so high in Indonesia, they should go and see. If you want to go from here to Mumbai, you have to give like crores of rupees because the prices are so high. The quotation is only very high. The value is not there. So consumption is never a problem. That's a Keynesian fallacy. It is the production, and production comes from hard work, saving, investment, capital, both physical and human capital accumulation, and then higher future income. We need to start this circle, and that's where the government comes into picture. They don't allow this virtual circle to start. They hamper the production activity. They hurt the wealth generating people of our economy. They transfer the resources from the productive sector to the unproductive sector.
Which is the government, obviously.
Exactly. So they are wasting everything. Like, they are just going to spend 105 trillion rupees on infrastructure project. Already the Prime Minister office warned National Highway Authority of India that you have around 90,000 crore rupees debt. Stop building roads. I don't know where they're going to build roads and dams and highways, nowhere. I think maybe a road to moon or Mars, maybe that will stimulate the economy.
So what you're saying, it seems like a very vicious cycle, because on the one hand, the government is stealing from the savers. It's basically reducing the power of pensioners, of people who basically retired and who have saved all their life. And it's resulting in an increase in prices. So a lot of people think that, oh, housing prices are so high, and, like, you know, all these prices are so high because of greedy capitalists, you know, charging profits and stuff. But, you know, once you understand the Austrian view, it's basically that inflation results in a rise in prices eventually, and then it basically gives more power to the state, because if people believe that it's the capitalists, then they'll basically go and tell the government, okay, you need to introduce control, price controls and rent controls, which, as you were saying, again results in a whole set of economic consequences that ordinary people just don't understand on the surface.
Right.
Also, another thing you were saying is that these drastic boom and bust cycles that we see in the economy, like the Great Depression of the 30s, the 2001 tech bubble, the 2008 housing crisis, are you saying that if there were no central banks, basically the business cycle that you were alluding to, this drastic boom and bust cycle, You're basically saying that it's caused by the central banks controlling the interest rate and controlling the credit. So can you just explain to people in a short way as to how a central bank would create a boom and a bust?
Okay. That will take some time, but anyway, I'll try. Because we have to understand the production structure and capital structure of the economy. So interest rate is a price of time. We human beings live our life in a time dimension and space also. So there is a past, there is present, there is future. Now, some things we want to consume in present, some things we want to consume in future. This is what we call time preference. So when we want to enjoy our present, we consume. We want to enjoy our future more, we save. So saving goes into investment and it creates capital, and that capital increases our future income so we can have a better standard of living in future. And this activity of present consumption and future consumption is coordinated by interest rate, which is nothing but a price of time. Now we all together determine the market rate of interest. Like 140 crore Indians, when they decide to consume and when they decide to save, the money, the resources, the wealth that they have generated, remember, out of that comes interest rate. Now, this interest rate is right now being determined by one guy, RBI governor. So how can RBI governor replace these 140 crore people's, you know, preferences and decisions? So when they manipulate this price, this interest rate, they generate bubble into different sectors of the economy. Entrepreneurs think that money is available for cheap borrowing, they start new project when actual real savings are not available. And because this money has been printed, the credit is unbacked by any kind of production. This is what Mises called fiduciary media. Yeah. So ultimately that results into higher prices. So when the prices become very high, the RBI's owner government will tell them to stop easing, you know, interest rate. So then they will increase the interest rate, and that is where the bust arrives. And you remember that in recession time, so many entrepreneurs are get caught. They all make error. In a free market economy, maybe one or two entrepreneurs can make mistakes, but not everybody.
Not systematic.
Yeah. This happens because the RBI is fooling everybody by manipulating the market interest rate. And that is how the recession starts. And recession is not a problem. Remember the artificial boom that was generated by the Reserve Bank, by the central bank, that was the problem. Recession is actually cleaning all these malinvestments. But the government will not allow that malinvest to be cleaned. They will continue to pump and, you know,
and
inflate new bubbles.
Prolonging the crisis. That they're
and that's why what we are seeing right now in India, what is happening is what we call stagflation. So on one side, economy is slumping and price is also rising. That is because since Raghuram Rajan and Urjit Patel left office in RBI, Shaktikanta Das has replaced them. He has reduced interest rate in 1 year for 5 times, which is a record number of times.
Yeah.
So he has pumped a lot of money into the market, which is going into stock market, for example.
Yeah.
The stock market is zooming to 42,000 and 43,000. This is nothing but a typical asset bubble. And it is going into other sectors also where prices are going up. So economy is not improving because there are problems like demonetization and GST. And on the other side, RBI is also generating inflation. So this manipulation of market interest rate is what creates the artificial boom. And once the boom has started, the bust is baked in the cake. The recession is going to be there today or tomorrow. And that's what we are seeing right now. After 2007, the previous UPA government pumped a lot of money into the market, quantitative easing, what they call. And this government is also printing and spending money like crazy. And that is why we are seeing economy is struggling right now. These bubbles are bursting, actually, what we are saying in real estate and auto sector. These bubbles are bursting. They are creating more bubbles also. They will also burst in the end.
You bring up a lot of interesting points with all of this. Firstly, you're saying about demonetization and GST, which brings us to the banking system and the problems we're seeing today. Mm-hmm. So what you're saying is that we need to remove the RBI from controlling the interest rate and we need to let the market decide the interest rate. So in a nutshell, how would banking tend to work in that environment? And, you know, maybe like this is my view as well, but I think that if we got the RBI out of the way, there would be no lender of last resort. So the banks would be held by the competition when they are creating more credit.
Right.
So if say for example we lived in a gold standard economy where everyone was using gold, and then they went and kept those gold in banks as deposits, and then the banks issued sort of claim checks to them. If they were to issue more claim checks and they had gold, then basically at the end of the week when they all settle their accounts,
clearing houses,
you know, some bank would be caught with their pants down and they would have to go under.
That's
The problem today is that the RBI doesn't let the banks go under. They're basically encouraging credit growth.
That is the reason why the central bank was created, to stop this thing from happening.
And this reminds me of an interesting quote from, I think, I don't remember the name of the Federal Reserve chairman, but someone asked him that, you know, what would the Fed do if unemployment was going up at the same time prices were going up, which is like literally never supposed to happen in their view. And he said they would resign. But, you know, this has
they
been
never
going
resign.
All over the world and, you know, none of them ever resign, basically.
They never resign. We have to resign for our lives. You know, so many people are committing suicide and, I mean, that kind of misery we cannot even mention. Right? See, these central bankers, these technocrats, they have no accountability whatsoever. I mean, they can destroy our lives of millions of people and they can just go back to their universities and start teaching again as if nothing happened. These are criminal offenses, creating I mean, if you and I will print currency, as I said, that's a criminal offense. But if they are doing it, it's just perfectly fine because they are doing it for the sake of the state.
I ask this a lot of status as well, like even people who believe in the government. If the government has theoretically given the power to the RBI and the commercial banks to create credit, why can't they just do it themselves and not have to borrow it from anyone else?
Yeah, like, they cannot do it because then they will be caught. See, I always tell everybody, I also provide, this solution is actually provided by Joseph Salerno. He's a monetary authority in Austrian economics. So he says that if the Treasury, if the Finance Ministry, for example, of India is going to print money, then we all know where the inflation is coming from.
Yeah.
And then they will be in trouble. You know, this is a complicated system. The primary dealers will sell the bond and buy the bond. And ultimately, it's nothing but printing money and spending it.
It's like passing it around and confusing
exactly,
the system.
Exactly, yeah. So the layman will not understand it. And they will think, oh, this is for our goodness sake. And they will just keep on believing in the system.
So what do you think are the dangers of us moving into a cashless direction? Because we're seeing, like, you know, governments all around the world have this war on cash. They basically want to eliminate cash and, like, you know, bring in this digital technocratic system where all our transactions are surveilled and everything is controlled centrally. So, you know, with things like demonetization and with our trend towards going cashless, let's say there was no cash in the economy, banks would, we would basically not be able to do a run on the bank. You know, even if they didn't have enough money, because, you know, there would be no money to remove. And maybe you can talk about the concept of bail-ins, which have been implemented in certain places like Cyprus, where the banks have stolen the depositors' money directly. So how that would tend to affect the depositors in a cashless economy.
I mean, it has happened in India with MPC.
So
what have they done is they have just bailed out the bank by using depositors' money. See, cashless economy is to control all of us. So, for example, you know, as we say, cash is king and debt is dumb. When you are using cash for some transaction, the government cannot track you. And that's what they don't like. They want to track us. They want to control us. They want to see what we are doing. So when we do it through the digital mechanism, for example, if I swipe my credit card somewhere, the government will know that where I'm spending my money. So, for example, let's talk about what happened on the night of demonetization in Surat. People use their cash to buy gold, a huge amount. Government has no idea who bought what. So right now they are telling the local income tax department to go and search all these things. But because it was a cash transaction, no, and many income tax officers were involved into that transaction. So nobody knows. So when you are transacting through cash, the transaction is over when it happens. Over here, there is a whole trail behind you. So they can just easily track you and then they can tax you. Then they can control you. For example, if they want to destroy somebody's life, they will just freeze their, you know, bank account. You cannot do anything.
Yeah, and this is the real danger.
That's
if
the big danger.
We move into something like this, where governments have full monopoly on the money supply, and we're not allowed to use alternatives like cash or gold, and even like Bitcoin, for example. They basically have full control of our lives, and, you know, we won't be able to buy or sell anything without their permission. So, you know, it's up to people if they decide that they want to move into such a future. You know, we're just trying to warn you of the consequences of something like that coming in and how it can affect you. So, Madhusudan, we've discussed, you know, a lot of problems today. And in the next segment of this, we will go into specifically some Indian problems that we're facing and how a free market libertarian approach would basically, you know, deal with them infinitely better than currently the state is dealing. So just as a summary, if you can tell viewers, you know, we've discussed all these problems, but what's the way out for someone thinking, you know, like, you know, I'm just overwhelmed, like these things are all wrong, but what can we do in our own lives to slow this thing down and eventually reverse it?
The first thing, the first thing is to free your mind from all these kind of ideas. You have to self-study, you have to read books. There is no shortcut into this field. Because as Mises said, and I also very strongly believe, this is a battle of ideas. World is ruled by nothing else but ideas, and these are wrong ideas that are, you know, in practice right now. We have to learn the right ideas. What they are not teaching you inside school and college and university classroom, that's what you have to learn. So you have to free your mind. You know, right now maybe we are physically free. We are not really physically also free. We cannot go everywhere. But let's assume that we are physically free. What is shackled, what is, you know, in chains right now is our minds. So people will have to free their mind. And once you're free from here, nobody can, you know, put you in chain again. Even if they put you in physically in jail, they still cannot stop you from talking, you know, and speaking your mind. So I will advise everybody to start reading this literature. I'm sure your website and your institution will also help them. I am also here to help everybody who wants to get into this field. And then spread these ideas wherever it is possible. Just write about it. You start like institution like you, this kind of programs. Talk about it, speak about it without worrying about converting anyone. We are not in the business of converting anyone. If somebody will understand what is happening, they will, you know, as I always say, understanding and motivation comes from inside, comes from within. Our job is like that of a prophet. We are just going to deliver the message. If people will understand the message, then one day things will change for better. Otherwise, whatever bad is bad already. You know, it's like many people say that why you're doing it, the government can come back again. I say that, okay, look, your house is on fire. You're not going to douse the fire just because you think, you know, it can catch fire again. No, right? So we have to fight this battle of ideas. We have to fight the evil. We have to fight the wrong. The system of state government is immoral and, of course, inefficient.
Yes, and it's immoral because it's initiating violence against peaceful people.
And it is based on violence.
Yeah, we believe in self-ownership, that you and I and everyone basically owns themselves, and then anything you mix your labor with in the physical world that is unowned, it becomes yours. So for a state to come, even to start a state, for example, they basically need to rely on theft.
It is based on conquest. Yeah. Absolutely, yes.
Maybe if you can throw in some authors that you would like to recommend to people. Okay. And also talk a little bit about the workshops you're doing, because I think you're doing phenomenal work in hosting these workshops throughout the year that are teaching people the basics of economics, the basics of money. So if people want to learn and come to you, maybe like how can they go about with it, and tell them a little bit about your courses.
Right,
your workshops.
So I am running Mises India Institute. So website is misesindia.in, and we are right now having three workshops. One is in January, it's called Economics for Everyone. So what I have seen is in the classrooms, they don't teach the sound economics. So I'm trying to, you know, fill that gap. And this is for everyone. This workshop is basically based on Henry Hazlitt's textbook Economics One Lesson. Yeah. So that is one workshop. The second workshop will come in June. It is Libertarianism 101. So people who want to understand the libertarian philosophy, they can attend that workshop. And in Diwali vacation, I also run this money and banking workshop. I go in local schools and colleges, and if somebody will invite us into their city, we are very happy to come there also. I run money and banking because these two topics are very important to understand, because by controlling money, the government actually controls us. So I run that workshop on that. And we are also planning to launch a week-long Mises boot camp. Like what Mises Institute does in America, Mises University.
They have it on the YouTube channel.
So we are also going to launch, maybe this year or probably from next year, I'm also going to launch that week-long program in Surat, Mises Bootcamp. So that will be an introductory certificate course in Austrian economics. So those who are interested in learning the ideas of Austrian school of economics, they are most welcome to join that workshop.
Most definitely, people. Please, you know, go to his website. His blogs are phenomenal. They'll give you a good insight on someone who's seeing things from a libertarian, freedom-minded perspective and analyzing events and economic happenings in India. Also, I'd recommend, please, if you have time, you know, come here in Surat and visit one of his workshops. I'm sure you'll learn a lot and it's going to greatly impact your life. I second what Madhusudan is saying. Basically, this whole system is working because the state and the controllers of the state, the hidden shadow forces, they basically have a control of our minds. And if we want to manifest freedom in the world and we want to take the world in a more positive direction, we have to take back control of our perception and our minds, because that is only when we'll be able to manifest ideas that actually create solutions and not cause more problems, like many people do by just believing in authority and believing in government. So again, thank you so much for coming on. It's just been a pleasure to speak to you, and I hope people benefit from our exchange today.
My pleasure, Johan.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.